Hello, my name is Ohad, and I will present the paper Upper and Lower Bounds on the Space Complexity of Detectable Objects. This is a joint work with Danny Hendler and Matan Rusanovsky. New non-volatile RAM technologies, or in short, NVRAM, introduced byte-addressable memory with a DRAM-like performance, which is also non-volatile. NVRAM is expected to replace in the near future some or even all of main memory. In past days, in order to recover an object, a copy of which had to be stored in a secondary storage, which is very costly in terms of space and time, both for maintaining the copy and using it in order to recover. NVRAM allows in-memory object recovery to be accomplished much more quickly by directly fixing the persistent main memory state. So to put it simply, instead of recovering by rebuilding the in-memory representation, this representation may be fixed and quickly reused, with the execution proceeding more or less from where it stopped. Israelevich et al. Presented the durable inerzability correctness condition for the crash recovery model. After a crash, the state of the object must reflect an history containing all completed operations. Crashed operation may or may not be part of this history. In addition to recover the state of the object itself, we also would like to allow processes to recover and continue their execution. For that, upon recovery, a process needs to be able to conclude whether its crashed operation took effect and also obtain its response. This notion was defined by Friedman et al. As detectability. Each process runs a recover procedure after a crash, which infers whether the crashed operation was linearized, and if so, also obtains its response. There are several challenges when designing a recoverable algorithm. The main challenge for durable inerzability is a crash after a partial effect of an operation. Assuming we would like to support an operation moving an element from stack A to stack B. A crash after removing an element from stack A, but before adding it to stack B, results an inconsistent state of the system. Detectability poses more challenges. One of which is that operation effect may be obliterated. For example, if process P push an element to the stack, which is then removed, in case of a crash, P cannot tell whether its push operation was completed by simply inspecting the state of the stack. Another problematic scenario is when two processes are performing the same operation and only a single operation took effect. In case of a crash, in order to retain the right response, the two processes must agree upon recovery to which of them this operation is attributed. This makes the design of detectable recoverable algorithms a hard task. In the last couple of years, several detectable implementations have been presented. Friedman et al. Presented a detectable queue. A detectable comparison swap was developed independently by both Atiyah et al. And Ben-David et al. Atiyah et al. Also presented a detectable read-write register. All these detectable implementations share the fact that an unbounded sequence numbers are used, and therefore all have an unbounded space complexity. This raises the question, does unbounded space is inherent to detectable implementations? In addition to the fact that sequence numbers are used, the sequence number must be passed to the operation as an argument. In other words, sequence numbers are not maintained by the operation itself, but rather by the caller of the operation. The only exception is the Atiyah et al. Compare and swap algorithm. However, it assumes that in case of a crash, the system provides the last instruction pointer. This raises the question, does this kind of auxiliary state, that is external information supplied by either the caller of the operation or the system, is necessary for detectable implementations? In this work, we provide a negative answer to the first question, presenting the first bounded space detectable read-write register implementation. We also present a bounded space detectable implementation for comparence warp. In addition, we prove the space complexity of our comparence warp implementation is asymptotically optimal by presenting a matching space lower bound of omega n shared bits for any detectable comparence warp implementation. Finally, we prove that for a large class of objects, auxiliary state is indeed required for detectable implementation. This class includes read-write register, comparence warp, queue, stack, and more. We emphasize that this is required in order to support detectability. Therefore, recoverability by itself does not require auxiliary state. The rest of the talk is structured as follows. We start with the bounded space detectable algorithms for both register and comparence warp. We proceed to the space lower bound of detectable comparence warp. We then present the auxiliary state theorem. And finally, we conclude with a summary and some open problems. For simplicity of presentation, these talks consider the system-wide crash model, in which all processes fail together. The paper also covers the individual crash model, in which processes can crash and recover independently of each other. The biggest challenge when designing a detectable register is the ABA problem. A write of V by P later may be overwritten. Therefore, if P crashes, it cannot tell whether its write was completed and observed by other processes by simply reading the content of the register. Previous work addressed this issue using unbounded sequence numbers, thus avoiding the write of the same value twice. Our implementation uses a toggle bit handshake technique to handle the ABA problem. So the toggle bit handshake works as follows. Each process has its own private toggle bit, and writes by this process are alternating between 0 and 1 value of the toggle bit. The register R represents the state of the simulated register. It consists of three fields. First is the value of the register. Second is the identifier of the last process wrote it, and finally, with which toggle bit was used in the last write. Processes are communicating using a binary handshake. So in order to perform a write, process P first reads the content of R to find Q, the last process that wrote R, and also the toggle bit B that was used by Q in this write. It then performs a handshake with Q using the opposite toggle bit, 1 minus B. This way it informs Q its write with toggle bit B was observed. Then P completes its own write to R and performs a handshake with all other processes, informing them that its write with the toggle bit of P, BP, was completed. The value written by P may be overwritten by Q with the same toggle bit B, only if Q first completes a write with the opposite toggle bit, 1 minus B, since the toggle bit is alternating. However, in this case, the handshake of Q at the end of its write with the opposite toggle bit 1 minus B will overwrite the handshake performed by P at the beginning of this write. Therefore, in case of a crash, the ABA problem can be solved by P, by by simply checking the state of the handshake bit between P and Q with the toggle bit 1 minus B. We now present the bounded space detectable comparance warp. As in the register, the ABA problem is the biggest challenge for detectable CAS as well. Again, previous works addressed it using unbounded sequence number. Our implementation uses a bounded bit vector to overcome it. So register C represents the state of the compare and swap object. It's composed of two fields, the value of the object and an n-bit vector. The P entrance of the vector is associated with process P. In order to perform a compare and swap, process P attempts to atomically write the new value and also flip its entrance in the vector. In case of a crash, the compare and swap of P took effect if and only if the entrance of P in the vector was flipped. Therefore, P can check it by simply reading the content of C. Our CAS algorithm uses n extra shared bits in addition to the bits used to store the value of the object. Next, we present a matching space lower bound. We prove that any obstruction-free detectable implementation of compare and swap for n processes has at least 2 to the power of n minus 1 different shared memory configuration, hence its bit complexity is omega n. This proves our implementation is asymptotically optimal. The proof is by inductive construction. Starting from the initial configuration, we let some process P perform compare and swap from 0 to 1 until the point where the next step by P will linearize the compare and swap and will affect the system. Therefore, if we let some other process Q at this point to perform compare and swap from 0 to 1, the CAS of Q will be successful since the CAS of P is yet to affect the system. However, if we let P take its next step, and only then we let Q perform compare and swap from 0 to 1, the CAS of Q must return false, since the CAS of P already changed the value of the object to 1. We have now two configurations, C and S, which is without the extra step of P, and CS, which is with the extra step of P. We now consider all possible configuration reachable starting from CS and CNS, where P does not take steps, and all CAS operation uses values different than zero. In the upper case, we know that the CAS of P is either not linearized at all, or linearized after the CAS of Q. Therefore, a crash at any point followed by the recovery procedure of P must return either fail or false. On the other hand, in the lower case, the CAS of P must be linearized before the CAS of Q. Therefore, in this case, a crash at any point followed by a recovery procedure of P must return true. Since crash event resets all local variables, no configuration in S1 and S2 can have the same shared memory state. Otherwise, a recovery of P starting from both configuration must return the same response, which is a contradiction. So we get that all configurations in S1 are different than all configuration in S2 regarding the shared memory state. Now the construction continues by induction on S1 and S2, each with n minus 1 processes, yielding 2 to the power of n minus 1 different shared memory configurations. We now present the auxiliary state theorem. As mentioned before, All non-detectable algorithms use auxiliary states. We define auxiliary state as an information supplied to the recoverable operation that is not required by its original non-detectable counterpart. We distinguish between two different types of auxiliary state. The first is via operation argument. For example, adding another argument such as sequence number. The second is via NVM. Before invoking the operation, data is written to non-volatile variable such that the operation can have access to it. We proved that for a large class of objects, any obstruction-free detectable implementation must use auxiliary state. The class includes register, CAS, stack, and more. However, max register is not included in this class. In the paper, we prove that there exists a detectable implementation for max register where no auxiliary state is used. The core idea behind the proof is as follows. Let process P runs and complete an operation op. We can then let another process take steps, and then we let P invoke a second instance of op followed by a crash. On the other hand, we can look on the same execution, except for the fact that we halt P just before returning from the first instance of OP. In both cases, after the crash, P runs the recovery procedure of OP. However, in the upper case, it recovers the second instance of OP, which took no steps. Therefore, it has no linearization point. On the lower case, P recovers the first instance of OP, which already took effect. If no auxiliary state is provided, then P has no way to distinguish between the two cases. And therefore, both recovery procedures will return the same response, and this is a contradiction. The construction can be applied to objects such that the same operation OP can be invoked twice by process P, and such that each instance of OP affects the response of some other operation. We call such an object a doubly perturbing object. So to conclude, we have shown that for many objects, any obstruction-free detectable implementation requires a model with auxiliary state, either supplied by the calling process or by the system. We showed that standard techniques, such as handshake and vector bit, designed originally to solve concurrency issues, can be used in order to achieve detectability as well. We believe that more known tools can be used in the crash recovery setting in order to achieve detectability. And finally, we show that detectable implementations with bounded space are possible. Let me finish with some open problems and future research direction. Our comparance warp algorithm, although asymptotically optimal, is using a single register with n bits. The question is, does there exist an optimal space comparance warp implementation using only registers of logarithmic size? Another interesting direction is to find more time and space lower bound for detectable objects. As the CAS lower bound illustrates, detectability comes with a price. An interesting question is, does there exist a trade-off between the complexity of the recoverable operation and the complexity of its recovery procedure, or that the best of both worlds can be achieved at the same time? And finally, we hope to explore universal detectable construction. Ben David et al. Presented one such construction named Capsules, opening the gate for more constructions to follow. Thank you.